Hello. In this third Russian film, I'm going to look at the period 1894 to 1905. In 1894, Nicholas II became the Emperor of Russia. He was a son of Alexander III, who died of natural causes. And in the first few years, say 4 or 5 years of his reign, Russia continued to modernize and industrialize and grow economically. This was mainly under the direction of the Minister of Finance, whose name was Sergei Vita. I think I mentioned him in the film about Alexander III. And he was Minister of Finance until 1903. He served Alexander III and Nicholas II. And Russia continued to grow and expand economically. There was, however, a worldwide economic slump at the turn of the 20th century, 1898, 1899, 1900, 1901. And what that meant was that for a lot of the people, ordinary working people that had moved from the countryside into the towns and cities to work in the new factories and mines and industries and on the railways in Russia, but life became very difficult. There wasn't enough work, and pay went down, there were food shortages. Life was very difficult. And I mean, on top of that, it had never really been a bed of roses as an ordinary worker in new Russian industries anyway. And this culminated in kind of a protest movement in 1905. Early in 1905, in January 1905, a protest march marched in the capital, St. Petersburg, to the Tsar's Winter Palace in the center of the city. And the protesters wanted to present the Tsar with a petition that was asking for better working conditions, a shorter working day, shorter working week, improved pay, fairly modest things, not asking for the end of the monarchy or not asking for workers' control of the factories or anything radical like that. They were asking for fairly modest things. And the protest was led by an Orthodox priest called Father Gapon. The protesters were even carrying portraits of the Tsar in their hands and holding them aloft to show their loyalty to the Tsar. And they were carrying pictures of Orthodox crosses to indicate that they were loyal, religious, traditional servants of the Tsar. But when they got to just outside the Winter Palace, the Tsar's guards opened fire and shot at the protesters, and they killed a huge number of the protesters. This caused outrage across Russia, and it caused other protests across Russia. It caused workers to go on strike. It caused workers to form unofficial trade unions, which they were banned from doing, not allowed from doing, but they went ahead and did anyway. And in many towns and cities, workers set up these things called Soviets. Now, a Soviet is the Russian word for a council. And the idea of the Soviet was to kind of organize workers' activities, to organize strikes and to share information, swap ideas, things like that. And there quite a lot of radical socialist well, radical socialists were attracted to these Soviets because they saw in them the opportunity for ordinary working people to express their political desires and to organize. In St. Petersburg, the capital, the deputy chairman of the Soviet there was a young man called Leon Trotsky, who went on, of course, to become very famous in the revolution of 1917 and in the early years of the communist government. But at the time, he was a member of a party called the Mensheviks, which was a communist Marxist political party, but it was a different political party that had split from the Bolshevik political party. And this split had occurred in 1903 over, I don't need to go into too much detail about it, but the split had occurred in this Marxist political party producing the Mensheviks and the Bolsheviks over how to achieve communism and how to get there in Russia. Anyway, so 1905, there are protests, there's outrage about these peaceful protesters being shot, there are strikes taking place, there are unions being formed, there are Soviets being formed. Russia then lost in a war to Japan, and it was a humiliating defeat for mighty Imperial Russia, the biggest country on earth, to lose to tiny Japan. I mean, perhaps not that surprising, as we know from the China course, Japan had actually modernized and industrialized very successfully from the mid-19th century onwards, whereas Russia hadn't really. It only really begun to catch up at the end of the 19th century. But anyway, Russia suffered this humiliating defeat to Japan, which also made a lot of people feel that, you know, perhaps the Tsar and the government were not capable really of properly governing the country and properly defending the country. And it also provoked mutinies in certain parts of the military. The most famous mutiny was on board a naval ship called the Potemkin, where the sailors on board the Potemkin rebelled against their officers, mutinied against them, killed their officers, and took control of the battleship. It was later made into a very famous film called Battleship Potemkin. Also in the empire, certain parts of the empire, the national minority countries in the empire, they were agitating and protesting and looking for more independence for their nations as well. And protest movements were growing up in parts of the empire like Finland, Poland, Georgia, Ukraine, as those parts of the empire were looking for a bit more independence. So Nicholas II had a lot on his plate in 1905. And he was advised by Sir Guy Vitter, who by 1905 had been promoted to a post called Chairman of the Council of Ministers. It was a bit like kind of being chief advisor to the Tsar. And Sir Guy Vitter advised the Tsar to give the people some of what they wanted. He advised the Tsar to set up a national parliament, a Duma. Now, you might remember that Alexander II had set up had set up municipal, he'd set up town and city dumas, assemblies in the 1870s. But this was Vitter trying to advise the Tsar, or he was advising the Tsar, to set up a national Duma, a national parliament in Russia, which there'd never been before. Reluctantly and begrudgingly, in order to try and calm the country down, Nicholas gave in to Vitter's advice. And in October 1905, he released, or he published, what's become known as the October Manifesto. And in the October Manifesto, he said, okay, I grant the people a Duma. There will be a national parliament for the first time. Now, some people in Russia were satisfied with that, particularly those liberals in Russia that believed that Russia needed to modernize and westernize, it needed to catch up with the West. They were satisfied that by setting up a national parliament, they would then have a say in the governance of the country and how it was run, and they were satisfied that this was a sign that Russia was moving forwards. The more radical people in Russia, the more radical socialists, the people who've been in the Soviets, weren't really satisfied with this Duma. They just thought that this was a bit of kind of window dressing by the Tsar to make it look like he was giving the people power. But the Tsar's reaction to those people and the more radical people was to clamp down on them. And the Soviets across the country were shut down by the army and police, and the leading members of the Soviets, people like Leon Trotsky, were arrested, put in prison. So at the end of 1905, the Tsar seems to have come through all the troubles that the country had had in that year. But there was a twist, and I'll talk about that in the next film.